Welcome to Palapin and Cowboy Church. We're so glad that you're joining us today. If this is your first time here to view Palapin County Cowboy Church, we're glad that you're watching the video today. My name is Roger Keck. I am the pastor here at the church, and we want to invite you to continue to come back. PalapinaCowboyChurch.com has all of the sermons on it, and they are posted each week. And so I hope that you will be able to look and check out these sermons for yourself. If you're searching for a church home, I agree that that may be one of the best ways to figure out if you'd like to come visit us or not is by looking at us online. So I hope you get a chance to review several of those. If you'd like to come visit us in person, eyeball to eyeball, we are at 2731 South FM 129 in Santo, Texas, 76472. And we would be glad to have you. We'd like to shake your hand and get to know you. If you are visiting with us and you are looking for a church home, or you enjoy being able to watch the videos at the house and you would still like to be a part of this church, you can participate by giving to this church and giving to the ministries of this church by going to the giving button that is located at PalapinaCowboyChurch.com under the title Giving, and it will prompt you to go in there and be able to give towards the ministries of this church. If you're listening by Pure Country Radio, and maybe you like doing that, you can also do that as well. That helps take care of the cost associated with broadcasting radio from this location. We're so glad that you're here. We'll hope that you join us. We hope that you come and see us. We look forward to getting a chance to meet you. God bless. As Mark leads us in, I saw the light.
I saw the light, I saw the light, no more.
stand up for me. Stand up for me. Keep going, Mark. We're going to do that chorus at least once more, maybe twice. Put your hand out down. Put your hand. There you go. Now you got it. There you go. Just lift some praise to the Lord. Two, one, two, three.
I saw the light. I saw.
To get Michael Cuddy to do a great song, one of my favorite songs. It's called I Can't Even Walk Without Holding Your Hand. Three, four, one.
I thought that number one would always be me. I thought I would be what I wanted to be. I thought that I could build on life's sinking sand, but I can't even walk without hope. That I could do a lot on my own. I thought I could make it all alone. I thought of myself as a mighty big man, but I can't even walk without you. Mountains too high and the valleys too
came to love, heal and forgive. He lived and died to buy my pardon. An empty grave is there to prove my Savior lives. Because he lives, I can face tomorrow. Because
something. We've been trying a couple of things here different lately, and I tell you, a lot of it has been because of the fact that we want to continue to encourage our youth to worship with us. And I tell you what, we got a great youth group here, and a lot of times we don't do a lot of the songs they're used to singing, but we're trying to add that to our repertoire. How about that big old word, all right? But you know, one thing we are doing is we're picking songs that are worshipful, and so this is a great song. It's called Our God. It's by Chris Tomlin. And if you know it, sing out loud. If you feel like standing, stand up. But here's what I do want you to do. If you don't know the words to this and you're just going, well, okay, that's great, I want you to worship to it, okay? Because I guarantee you this is an awesome song. And so we're going to try this for you. I hope that you'll sing along with us. You've got the words in front of you, okay?
There's no one like you, none like you. Into the darkness you shine, out of the ashes we rise. There's no one like you, none like you. Our God is greater, our God is stronger. God, you are higher than any other. Our God is healer, awesome in power. Our God, into the dark. As you shine, out of the ashes we rise. There's no one like you, none like you. Our God is greater, our God is stronger. God, you are higher than any other. Our God is healer, awesome in power. Our God is stronger. God, you are higher than any other. Our God is healer, awesome in power. Our God, our God is for us, then who could ever stop us? And if our God is with us, then what could stand against? And if our God is for us, then who could ever stop us? And if our God is with us, then what could stand against? What could stand against? Our God is greater, our God is strong. God, you are higher than any other. Our God is healer, awesome in power. Our God, our God is greater, our God is stronger. God, you are higher than any. And if our God is with us, then what could stand against? What could stand against? You are higher than any other. is healer, awesome in power, our God, our God.
Sing that again, will you?
Our God is greater, our God is stronger, God, you are higher than any other. Our God is healer, awesome in power, our God, our God.
Would you bow your heads with me, please? Father, we just come to you this morning. We thank you because you are a mighty God in charge of all things. You are Lord, you are Savior, you are God. Father, we love you. We praise you in the midst of this place today. In Jesus Christ's name I pray. Amen. Hey, Dana, would you go do me a favor? My biggest fear in all of the world in my life was to get up to the podium without my notes. And darned if I didn't do that today. I'm telling you what, I think they're back there in my office, I hope. Whew, that's kind of dangerous, isn't it? Oh, well, I'll kill some time while she gets back. So at least I hope that's where they are. I had them in my hand earlier, and I'm not really sure what I did with them. But anyway, good to see everybody. Y'all glad to be in the house of the Lord today? Maybe God was just telling me it's time to pray and go home. What do you think? You reckon that maybe that's what he was trying to do? Yeah. He's up here telling me he might get to go eat lunch a little bit early. I don't know. You might do it, brother. You sure might. It's over, brother. It's totally over. It sure is. All right, here we go. Anyway, I want to say two things. One is this lovely lady that's bringing my notes and saving the day has a birthday on Wednesday. Yes. I'm not going to tell you how old she is. I'm just going to tell you it's somewhere around 21, right? Thank you. Yes. And the second thing I want to ask you to continue to do is remember Ike Mercer. Ike Mercer is our worship leader here. Ike is having chemo treatments done, and his doctor has asked him to stay indoors and away from everybody because of his immunity, and his immune system is down. But Ike is very special to us. He does an awesome job, and we just want to continue to pray for him. And then I'm also going to ask you that if you'd put on your prayer list, put Debbie on there. Debbie's going to have some back surgery, and I'm telling you what, we're going to have two major holes in this band for a while, and so we're just going to pray them through it, and then the rest of us are going to do the best we can and try to fill some enormous shoes here. But we're going to have some guest singers with us over the course of the next couple of months. Devin, of course, is going to be singing again with us. That's always good. We like her. Kimmy Hudson will be singing. I know we're going to have her back. And I tell you what, we're just looking forward to having all these ladies that have got so much talent. And I know we're going to get Pat Clary to come sing again, too. So, yeah. And she may not know that till right now, but I will. Anyway, I'm glad that you're here. I'm glad that you're in the house of the Lord. Everybody feel good? Is the temperature all right? Okay, good. I know it's a little humid. We were expecting rain today. Thank the Lord it did not rain, and we got our memorial service in on the porch. That was nice. Appreciate Steve Smith. Steve Smith put all that together for us this morning, so he just did an incredible job. Yeah. We just got a lot of talented people. It is Memorial Day weekend. Amen. Great time for us to think about freedom. And I tell you what, I came this close to canning what I was going to do in this series and preaching on freedom, but I think you need this series too much for me to do that. And so that's why we decided to have something on the porch rather than in here today. So if you came expecting to hear some kind of patriotic message today, guess what? You're going to have to come back in June. Because the whole month of June into the 4th of July, that's what I'm going to do. I'm going to preach on freedom, okay? Yeah. But I think that this message today is just too critically important. It's on sight. How many of you have to wear glasses to see? How many of you still can't see even when you have the glasses? Okay, very good. All right. I'll tell you what. So sight ought to be something that you need, correct? You understand the gravity of that. So I hope and pray all of you understand that the reason I'm so passionate about seeing this message get preached and this series get preached is because I believe in the Word of God. I believe it's our lifeline. I believe we need it every day, every second of the day, and I get it. I know sometimes you can't spend all day, every day reading your Bible, but for goodness sake, carve out some time to do it. You know what I mean? Because we've got to have nourishment for our soul, right? And it comes from the bread, which is the Word of God. It comes from the water, which is the Word of God. And it comes from having sight. And by sight, what I'm going to tell you a little bit more about that today, it means being able to understand and discern what the Bible is saying. Amen? You know, it's one thing to read it. It's another thing to understand it, isn't it? Amen? Amen. Good. But we need this. Now, I want to remind you real quickly, and we had a lady in the church remind me of this last week, and maybe I left this out, so I want to go back and correct myself if I've left it out. But the one thing I want you to understand is the Bible has physical meaning, and it has spiritual meaning. Are you all good with that? Okay. So as you read your Bible and you have vision or you have sight, the Holy Spirit speaks to your heart, and that way you are able to discern what the Word of God is saying. But I'm going to tell you, if you do not have spiritual eyes, you will not understand this book. You won't. And that's why so many people in the world today are running around lost. That, you know, they go, well, yeah, I've seen that Bible. You know, or I've read it, and I just don't believe what it says. Right? Have you heard those kind of people? It's because they are not reading the Word of God through spiritual eyes. Good. Yes, preacher. Amen. Woo! Y'all gonna get excited. Anyway, I want to tell you this, and I know I've told you this before, but I'm going to reiterate it. Preachers help explain what Scripture says, okay? In other words, we give you a practical application for Scripture, but it is not a substitute for the Scripture itself. Listen, if you don't get anything else today, get this. Without this, you will not change. A preacher can't change you, an elder can't change you, a lay pastor can't change you, a deacon can't change you, your mama can't change you, but the Word of God will. Amen? It will. So I want you to spend time in the Word. That's why I didn't want to just stop this series and do freedom today, even though I think freedom's important, because I think we need to get in the Word of God. If you wonder why we are so messed up from the floor up right now in this country, it's because we have put this down and quit living by it. Quit living by it. Woo! So I want to talk to you about today about spiritual blindness. And we're going to start with a scripture found in Matthew chapter 8, and I hope you bring your Bible with you. Now, yes, we put it up here, but it is so important for you to have it because you need to mark this in your Word and go back and read it later. But Matthew chapter 8, we're going to start in verse 13 here in just a moment. And today what I'm going to do is I'm going to give you this this scripture, and then I'm going to make 3 points, and then I'm going to come back and explain the scripture. So we're going to read it, talk about some other things, and then come back and explain what this scripture we're fixing to read means. So will you let me do that? Okay, good. All right, well, if you would, stand with me. Gentlemen, if you'll remove your cover in honor of God's precious and holy Word today. In Matthew chapter 8, starting with verse 13, then he left him. He got back into the boat and crossed to the other side. The disciples had forgotten to bring bread. Am I, is that right? Yeah. What did I say? Oh, Mark. I'm sorry. I did say Matthew. All right. I'm sorry. Mark. Okay. All right. Let's try this again. Is everybody in the right spot except for the preacher? I promise you I have the right scripture here. I just didn't give you the right place to look for it. All right, I'm going to start reading again, verse 13. Then he left them. He got back into the boat and crossed to the other side. The disciples had forgotten to bring bread except for one loaf they had with them in the boat. Be careful. I like these words right here. Be careful, Jesus warned them. Watch out for the yeast of the Pharisees and that of Herod. They discussed this with one another and said, it is because we have no bread. Now, this is going to be important here in a minute, so you're going to want to underline this. Aware of their discussion, Jesus asked them, "Why are you talking about having no bread? Do you still not see or understand? Are your hearts hardened? Do you have eyes but fail to see, and ears but fail to hear? And don't you remember when I broke the 5 loaves for the 5,000, how many basketful of pieces did you pick up?" 12, they replied. "And then when I broke the 7 loaves for the 4,000, how many basketfuls of pieces did you pick up?" And they answered, 7. He said to them, "Do you still not understand?" Let's go to the Lord in prayer. Father, I thank you so much for your word today. Father, I just pray that you would just penetrate our hearts, Father, that you would move in our lives. Father, again, we thank you for your word that is so clear. And Father, I pray that today would be the day that it would change us. In Jesus Christ's name, amen. Thank you. You may be seated. All right. Now, quick question. And by the way, before I ask you this question, I want you to understand that God knows your heart. God sees your heart, okay? So if you answer this question with your head, then God's going to know that you're lying. Okay? So I'm just asking you to think about it. Now, you may truly believe this. Do you believe that God heals all diseases? Okay, how many of you believe he does? Okay, how many of you are not sure? And it's okay if you're not sure. Okay. All right, good. Now, second question I want to ask you is, do you believe that God forgives all sin? We see some hands. Okay. We better hope he does. Oh, we're in big, giant trouble, right? Big, giant trouble. Yeah. So I want to tell you a quick story. The reason I'm asking this question, there was a pastor, he was asked this question, "Do you believe that God heals all diseases?" And to which the pastor quoted this scripture. He said, now this guy asked the question to this other fella, and the other fella quoted this scripture. It's found in Psalm 103:3. And the scripture says, "He forgives all your sins and heals all of your diseases." Amen? So let me ask you this. When you read scripture like that, do you believe that scripture is true? Okay, so it means he has the capability of healing anything. He has the capability of forgiving anything. Okay, just want to make sure. All right, this first pastor looked at listened to him read this, and he said, "Well, wait a minute, preacher. Do you believe that God actually heals all diseases?" To which the second pastor, once again, in Psalm 103:3, said, well, look right here. And he opened his Bible and he said, "Look right here." And he reads the same scripture, "Who forgives all your sins and heals all your diseases." To which the first pastor looked intently at the scripture and said, "I just don't see it. I just don't see it." Now, this is coming from a preacher. So my question is, why would a person not see that? Because even preachers can have spiritual blindness. If preachers can have it, certainly all the rest of us can. Amen? Yeah. So, let me give you 3 points about spiritual blindness today. If you got something to write on, I want you to write it down. Now, by the way, let me just quickly tell you, we are going to look up a ton of scripture today. Okay? Now, the reason I'm doing this is just like I said a while ago. It is not what I say that will change you. It is what God says in his word that will. Okay? So I would rather scripture preach to you this morning than me. Is that all right? So it is Bible Drill 101, and I tell you what, I'm about to burn up the fingers on my media team because they've been typing away. You know, they're going, "Good night, preacher. You used to do like one scripture and that was it. Now we're doing 50, you know? I mean, we're doing half the Bible. That's all right. All right, Isaiah chapter 42, verse 18. Isaiah 42:18. "Hear, you deaf. Look, you blind, and see. Who is blind but my servant and deaf like the messenger I send? Who is blind like the one in covenant with me, blind like the servant of the Lord? You have seen many things, but you pay no attention. Your ears are open, but you do not listen. Now, I reckon who he's talking to. Us. He's talking to about spiritual things. He's talking to us. He said, you show up in church week after week after week, and you listen to things, but you're not really hearing anything. You're not really reading the word and understanding the word for yourself, which, by the way, makes you blind and deaf. So let me give you a piece of biblical advice. If you've walked into this church and you think you're all that when it comes to the Bible, I got to tell you something. You ain't. You're spiritually blind still. Because those of us who know that God speaks through his word know that we have to constantly stay in that word and stay focused on that word, and there is something new in there every time we look at it. Every time we look at it. Isaiah 43:8, lead out those who have eyes but are blind, who have ears but are deaf. Jeremiah 5:21, hear this, you foolish and senseless people. That kind of hurts, Lord. I don't know if I want to be called foolish. But he says you are, because you have eyes but you don't see. You have ears but you don't hear. By the way, one of the things that cause spiritual blindness, or that spiritual blindness does, is steal your understanding. It steals your understanding. In other words, you don't get it. You don't understand it. Ezekiel 12:2, son of man, you are living among a rebellious people. They have eyes to see, but do not see. They have ears to hear, but they do not hear. For they are a rebellious people. And by the way, rebellion also causes spiritual blindness. Zephaniah 1:17. I will bring such a distress on all people that they will grope about like those who are blind, because they have sinned against the Lord. Now, this is going to hurt most of us in here, if not all of us. I want to tell you something. Walking in known sin causes spiritual blindness. Now, it is not up to me to determine what your sin is. I've got plenty of it myself. But I'm telling you what, every single day I have to repent, and every single day I have to turn to God and say, God, forgive me of my sin, because I am never going to understand what that word says until I've repented and come back to God. Does everybody understand that? Yeah. Okay, good. Matthew 13:14-15. In them is fulfilled the prophecy of Isaiah. You will be ever hearing but never understanding. You will be ever seeing but never perceiving. For this people's heart has become calloused. Anybody besides me realize that we as a country have kind of gone backwards in the past few years, and it's because we become calloused to the word of God? Because we don't care about it anymore. Or we don't believe it to be all true. Or we don't believe that at least all of it's true. Okay, portions of it, okay, I can live with portions of it. But wait a minute, if you're going to convict me that I don't want to believe that that part of it's true, and our heart gets calloused. Amen. All right, go back and read this. I'm not even sure where I'm at. All right, here we go. For this people's heart became callous. They hardly hear with their ears, and they have closed their eyes. Otherwise, they may see with their eyes and hear with their ears. Now, do you think that God's trying to tell us something? Look at the amount of scripture on this already. Do you think that we have a problem actually hearing and understanding and seeing and being able to understand? Does anybody besides me think we've got a problem with that? Look at the rest of it. It says they need to understand where their hearts and turn. By the way, the word turn means repent, which is what I just got through saying a while ago. Turn. And then it says, I would heal them. Jesus says, they have been able to see with spiritual eyes, hear with spiritual ears, to understand God's word. And they must do so, so that they will turn from their sin, and then I can heal them. Now, the reason people are not spiritually healed, and by the way, I'm not so sure that it's not physically and spiritually, okay? But I'm going to talk about the spiritual today. The reason people are not spiritually healed is because they do not turn from their sin. They are content in it, they like living in it, and they don't have any plans on changing. The reason they don't turn from their sin is because they don't realize what the sin is doing to them. The reason they don't realize what sin is doing to them is because they are spiritually blind. Because they're blind, right? Have you ever run across that person, and maybe you're it, where you've had somebody tell you, gosh, I just don't know why you keep doing the same stupid thing over and over and over again. They see it, but you don't see it, right? And we keep making the same mistake over and over and over again. It's because we never repented from it the first time. We just continued to march along in it. I'm going to preach today. You all right with that? I'm going to preach. Woo. I tell you what, this causes people to remain physically, emotionally, and spiritually sick. This is why they never get well. You know, they are just spiritually in the dump. And they walk around and they go, well, I just don't know what's wrong. I mean, I pray. I go to church. Once in a while, I'll read my Bible. And I just don't get it. I have the same cotton-picking issues I've always had. It's because you never fully took off the blinders and said, God, I want to see what your word says to me. Change me with your word. Change me with your word. Psalm 107:20. He sent out his word and healed them. He sent out his word. Some of you don't believe that. He sent out his what? He sent out his what? Yeah, he sent out his word first, and then he healed them. You think we got sick people in this country? You think we got spiritually sick people in this country? Is there anybody that you know of that needs the word of God? Whew. Now, by the way, we're talking about spiritual blindness. But in the same sense, as I said, it has a physical and a spiritual kind of meaning. Have you ever been right by somebody? Maybe you walked into church today and somebody was standing over there and you looked right at them and you honestly could not remember who they were. Or how better yet, how about we do this? You're looking over there, you see them, they're looking right at you, and you're over there just doing this number big time, and they pretend, you know, it's like, well, they don't even see me. Have you ever done that? I got to tell you a story. Now, I know I'm going to tell it on me this time. I'm leaving my wife out of this, okay? Y'all don't think I learned my lesson, but I did, okay? It's too hot to be in the doghouse right now. You know what I mean? Anyway, here's the way it works in my house. You know, I have this issue of being blinded by whatever it is. And I don't think it's not what I would say spiritual blindness, although maybe sometimes I do have some of that. But I can be, Dana can say, would you go get the ketchup out of the pantry? Now, I'm going to tell you, some of you guys are going to be like this. Right? And I'll walk to the pantry over there and I'll open the door and I'll look. And I'm going, I know for a fact, if I go back in there and tell her it's not in there, I'm going to be in trouble, right? So I take a second look to make sure that I don't go in there and look stupid, okay? Which is not hard for me to do sometimes, by the way, just so you know. But anyway, so I take another look, and I go all the way through there, and I said, I don't see it. I said, Dana, it's not in here. I can just hear the air comes right out of her. So she walks in. Well, there it is right there. That's all I needed right there. I was right there, right in front of you this whole time. Can anybody feel my pain? Amen. Lady, yeah, amen. Thank you, brother. Men are the worst about that. I'm sorry. I don't know what it is. Maybe, you know, it might be clothes. It could be. I don't know what it is. But we just can't see things, can we? You know. Okay. All right. I thought that was a good illustration anyway. Psalm 107:20. He sent out his word and healed them. He rescued them from the grave. He rescued them from the grave. What grave is he talking about? He's talking about the spiritual grave. He's talking about your soul. He's saying, look, if you will read this word, digest this word, and be open with vision and hearing to what it says, it will save your soul. Wish it had saved me from finding the ketchup or something, but it didn't. Pride causes spiritual blindness, number two. Pride. Oh, boy. Here we go. The only reason we could ever want to continue in sin is because of our pride. It's because of our pride. And it is because we have a rebellious spirit in us. Have you ever said, well, I don't really have a problem with that? That's really not something I have to deal with. I know a lot of people that do, but I don't deal with that. Pride gets in the way of us even admitting the fact that we even have a problem to start with. Amen? Right. That rebellious spirit, John chapter 9, verse 39 through 41. Jesus said, for judgment I have come into this world so that the blind will see, and those who see will become blind. Well, this is interesting. Some Pharisees who were with him heard him say this and asked, what? Are we blind too? And Jesus replied, if you were blind, you would not be guilty of sin. But now that you claim you see, your guilt remains. Let me explain this. He's saying, I came into this world so that people that are spiritually blind could be saved. Y'all think about it for just a minute. What happened to Paul? You remember the Apostle Paul? The day that Paul, the Apostle Paul, was saved, what happened to him? The Bible says that scales fell off of his eyes, right? In other words, he was blind to the truth. He was blind to the truth, but when Christ entered him and the Holy Spirit became part of his life, the blinders came off. Now, what Jesus is saying is those of you who say you don't need Jesus and his word to see spiritual things needed in your life and in this world, you have just been made blind to the things of God. All right? Now, this is kind of tough. You're going to stay with me. Jesus tells the Pharisees that if they would just admit this, and by the way, he's telling us this too, if we would just admit that we cannot see spiritually without Jesus, then they would have no sin. And the reason why they would have no sin is because Jesus would wipe it away. Jesus would wipe it away. It's not that they're not guilty of sin. It's just Jesus would take the price for it. Amen? Punishment for it. But since you say that you can see, and you can see without me, your sin remains in you. That's what he's saying. Now, I got to tell you a story today. Y'all are blessed because we get to have two more baptisms today. By the way, I didn't tell Holly I was going to do this. Holly, I'm going to tell you a quick story on you, okay? Good? It's all good. It's all good. But Holly's getting baptized and her son's getting baptized today. Isn't that awesome? Yeah. So I want to tell you a story about how Jesus Christ lifts the blinders off of us and causes us to see spiritual things that we may have thought we knew, but until God revealed his word to us, we never knew. Holly was telling me the other day, we were sitting in my office and we were talking, and she said, you know, Rob, where's Rob? Rob Kennedy, where's Rob? Rob's here someplace. Rob, there he is. Stand up, Rob. Rob, you saw Rob a while ago. Rob was up here doing the announcements. Rob is our arena lay pastor, okay? And every time we do an arena event, Rob goes out there and he gives a devotional. You can sit down. And he gives a devotional, and Holly was out there one time, and Rob was giving this devotional on baptism. And it's not that Holly didn't know what baptism was. She'd been exposed to that for a long time. But as Rob was giving this devotional, it began to penetrate into Holly's heart. Wait a minute. Have I been spiritually baptized? And it started weighing on her. And so Rob got done with his message. They did the event, and Holly went back to her mom and said, Mom, have I been baptized? And her mom said, no. Well, all this time, Holly thought she'd already been baptized, that everything was hunky-dory fine. But the Spirit of God in the Word came over her in that arena out there, and she said, you know what? I need to be baptized. That's what I'm talking about. That's exactly what I'm talking about. You know, because we can be floating along here thinking we are all just hunky-dory fine, everything's okay. And then all of a sudden, God slaps us with the word, and it penetrates our heart and goes, uh-oh, something in me needs to change. I need to do something different. The blinders come off, the spiritual vision comes into focus, and we're ready to make a change and do what the Bible tells us we need to do. Amen? Number three, Jesus opens blind eyes. Boy, amen to that. Mark 8:22-25, they came to Bethesda, and some people brought a blind man and begged. I bet I got these backwards. Blind and begged Jesus to touch him. He took the blind man by the hand and led him outside the village, where he had spit on the man's eyes and put his hands on him. Jesus asked, do you see anything? He looked up and he said, now I want you to mark this in your Bible. If you got your Bible open, mark this. He says, I see people, they look like what? They look like trees walking around. Now, that's an interesting analogy, isn't it? Because you're thinking Jesus spit on his eyes and he put his hands on him. And the first thing this guy sees is figures that look like trees, men that look like trees. I'm fixing to tell you why this is. Once more, Jesus put his hands on the man's eyes. The eyes were open. His sight was restored, and he saw everything clearly. Now, real quickly, at first glance of this, you would think, well, Jesus didn't get it right the first time. It took him twice. Have you ever known anything to take Jesus twice to do? Right? How can the Creator of the world, the perfect Father, our Lord and our Savior, our Christ, require two chances at something? There's a reason. Psalm 1, 1 through 3. Blessed is the one who does not walk in step with the wicked, or stand in the way that sinners take, or sit in the company of mockers, but whose delight is in the law of the Lord, who meditates on his law day and night. That person is like a... Are you starting to get a little bit of sense of something here? Yeah, they're like a tree planted by streams of water, which yields its fruit in season, whose leaf does not wither. Whatever they do prospers. Psalm 52:8, that I am like an olive tree flourishing in the house of God. Psalm 92:12, the righteous will flourish like a palm tree. Jeremiah 17:7-8, but blessed is the one who trusts in the Lord, whose confidence is in him. They will be like a tree planted by the water that sends out its roots by the stream. I'm not going to read the rest of it. You can. Isaiah 55:12, you will go out in joy and be led forth in peace. The mountains and the hills will burst into song before you, and all of the trees will clap their hands. Well, let me ask you something. Have you ever seen a tree clap its hands? What he's talking about is he's talking about you. You just did it. You are the tree, and you just clapped your hands because Jesus spoke into your heart right then, didn't he? Through his word, I might add. Through his word. Just talking about people. Matthew 7:17, likewise, every good tree bears good fruit. But a bad tree bears bad fruit, doesn't it? He's not teaching us how to take care of trees. He's teaching us how to be a tree rooted in the word of God. That's what he's teaching us. Zechariah 4:12-14, again I ask him, what are these two olive branches beside the two gold pipes that pour to the golden oil? Now, if you've been, by the way, participating in Revelation Bible study, how many of you have been watching that? I know a lot of you have not been able to be here, but how many of you watched it? Do y'all remember us talking about the two witnesses? Okay, chapter 13 and 14, we've been in this, and we've been talking about the two witnesses, the 144,000 and the two witnesses, right? Did you know that Zechariah is talking about those two witnesses? God showed him two trees that represented those two witnesses in the book of Revelation. Now you tell me God doesn't have a plan. Wow. So trees represent people in the Bible. Jesus puts his hands on this blind man and he asks him, what do you see? The man said, I see men like trees. And then he put them on his eyes again and restored everything clearly. No, it does not take God twice to get something right. So let me tell you what he did. And listen very carefully. This is good stuff. This is worth the price of admission today. The first time he healed his spiritual eyes. The second time he healed him physically. He gave him spiritual sight before he ever gave him physical sight. Now, so if you want proof of this, back up before this story of the blind man. And keep in mind that Jesus fed 5,000 one time and 4,000 another time. Y'all remember that? Okay, I don't have time. I got to hurry because I don't have enough time to go back and read all this. But back in Mark, where you were earlier, then he left them, got back into the boat, and crossed to the other side. Mark 8, by the way. The yeast of the Pharisees and Herod, the disciples had forgotten to bring bread except for the one loaf they had with them in the boat. Be careful, Jesus warned them. Watch out for the yeast of the Pharisees and that of Herod. They discussed this with one another and said, it is because we have no bread. Uh-oh. Jesus is ticked because you guys forgot the bread. Well, think about it. That's what they're saying, right? We're in big trouble. He's mad. He may not get over this. I don't know. It may take some doings, but we didn't bring the bread. He's mad about the bread. And look what it says right here. Aware of their discussion, Jesus asked them, why are you talking about having no bread? Do you still not understand? Are your hearts hardened? Do you have eyes, but you fail to see, and ears, but you fail to hear? And don't you remember? In other words, think back. You guys were with me. You ought to know the answer to this. When I broke the five loaves for 5,000, how many baskets full of pieces did you pick up? And they said 12. And when I broke the seven loaves for the 4,000, how many baskets of pieces did you pick up? And they answered 7. And he said to them, do you still not understand? Now, I want to tell you what that means. You ready? This is eye-opening. Jesus is saying, if I wanted bread, I'd mix them up myself. Miss Bears is mine, saith the Lord. Amen? Yes. He said, I'm not talking about bread. We got all the bread we want, right? There's 13 dudes in this boat. And you would think after feeding 5,000 with five loaves and 4,000 with seven loaves, or do you really honestly think we're going to have an issue with bread today? Jesus says, I'm not talking about physical bread. I'm talking about spiritual bread. I'm talking about the spiritual bread. Now, I'll tell you one more thing. We're going to pray. If you do not read this book with spiritual eyes, you are going to miss what God's trying to tell you. Whew. If you do not read this book with spiritual eyes, you are not going to turn away from the sin that's in your life. You will remain sick and net deep in your sin and despair. Because the only person that can change you is Jesus Christ. So I want you to bow your head, close your eyes. Gentlemen, if you remove your cover. I got to ask you something. I ask this every week, but I got to ask today. Maybe this is your first time in Cowboy Church. I don't know. We're not what I like to call like most churches, and I'm okay with that. But I want you to know we are a Bible-based church, and we believe in the authority of Jesus Christ. We believe that that authority can and will change your life if you invite him into your heart. But you have to do it. God's not going to force his way in. He's not going to beat the door down. He's simply going to knock at the door of your heart and ask to come in. And the Bible says that we have to let him come in. And that's what I'm asking you to do today. I'm asking you to give your heart and soul and your life over to Jesus Christ right now. I'm asking you to have spiritual eyes so that you can see the Word of God. And I believe, and with all my heart, or I wouldn't do it, that that Word is going to change you and make you a different person. But you got to do it. So as we pray this morning, every head bowed, every eyes closed, I want you to search your own heart. Do you have a relationship with Jesus Christ? Is he the Lord and Savior of your life? Father, we come to you this morning. Father, we thank you so much for this opportunity to be in this house today. Father, I thank you for your word, your message that you have preached through your word. Father, we take no credit for that. We give the glory to you because it is through your word we are changed. And Father, today I believe there is a life in this building that's been changed according to your word. Father, I pray that you would take the spiritual blinders off of them, that they would receive the grace and the mercy that you're ready to pour out in their life. Father, we thank you for the blood of Jesus Christ shed on Calvary for every single one of us. Father, we receive that blood and that forgiveness, Father, as we confess our sin to you and as we repent of that sin. Father, we believe that you not only died, but you rose from the grave on the third day. Father, we submit to you as the King of kings and the Lord of lords, and we confess with our mouth and we believe with our heart that you are risen from the grave. Father, come into our lives and change us. In Jesus Christ's name I pray, amen.